From prominent mountain ranges boasting impressive trail systems and chilling paranormal activity, to historic Catholic missions whose grounds are purportedly stalked by the dead after dark. Are you ready for our second list of picks for some of the most haunted places in Arizona? Number 5, Maricopa Point. Maricopa Point, located off Hermit Road on the south rim of the Grand Canyon and included in the Grand Canyon National Park in Arizona, is a prominent viewpoint situated atop an unnervingly narrow promontory, which extends 100 feet out over the canyon's formidable cliff face that offers a breathtakingly unobstructed view of the canyon, the Colorado River, and pretty much everything else within ocular range. The Grand Canyon itself first became popular through the 1880s after railroads were constructed near, and pioneers began developing town sites and landmark stops intended to draw early tourism. In 1893, President Benjamin Harrison would officially establish the Grand Canyon Forest Reserve, and later President Theodore Roosevelt would first establish the Grand Canyon Game Reserve in 1903, and next the Grand Canyon National Monument in 1908. The site would finally be declared a national park in 1919 under order of President Woodrow Wilson. Hermit Road was initially laid from 1934 to 1935 and was constructed by the Civilian Conservation Corps, along with the Bureau of Public Roads and National Park Service. The road would undergo a range of rehabilitation and restructuralization efforts in 2008, after which, in an effort to preserve the populace of a rare species of plant, Maricopa Point's parking area pavement was removed entirely. Drives and trails would later be resurfaced in 2020. Today, the site remains open to the public and offers shuttle buses to and fro, along with a nearly endless expanse of trails perfect for hiking, biking, and riding. Maricopa Point has long been surrounded by ghost stories and legends of paranormal activity, with many visitors reporting experiences they just couldn't explain, including extreme cold spots in the heat of summer, frequent electronic malfunctions, and disembodied voices and whispers heard on phone calls and from empty areas. A scattering of informal investigations have yielded surprisingly high EMF levels, chilling EVPs, and orbs and half-formed images discovered later in photographs and video. And a number of first-hand accounts tell of the sounds of someone shoveling or scraping gravel, often accompanied by boot steps heard from just off the parking area. Disturbingly, a range of stories tell of instances in which visitors feel as if they're being watched or followed by someone or something unseen, with a handful describing the feeling of invisible hands touching or even grabbing at their persons. Lastly, quite possibly the most famous legend surrounding Maricopa tells that at some point through the 1930s, a CCC employee working on the overlook took a tumble and fell over the edge to his death. His spirit has been known to manifest, most often at sundown, as either a black smoke that hovers near the railing, or as a full-bodied apparition working on the edge of the overlook, possibly attempting to finish the job he was never able to in life. Number 4, Mission San Javier del Bac. Mission San Javier del Bac, located about 9 miles south of downtown Tucson, Arizona, and set within the Tohono O'odham National San Javier Indian Reservation, is a historic Spanish Catholic mission boasting the impressive title of being the oldest intact European structure in the expanse of the state. The mission was initially established in 1692 by one Father Eusebio Francisco Quino, with construction of the first mission building beginning in 1700, around 2 miles from our present-day site. Sadly, this original mission was destroyed in an Apache attack in 1770, leading to our present mission building's construction from 1783 to 1797 under the orders of Franciscan Fathers Juan Bautista Valderrain and Juan Bautista Lorenz. This new mission was to be constructed entirely by a workforce of O'odham natives. Tragically, in 1828, the Mexican government would ban all Spanish-born priests from practicing, resulting in the last father at the mission departing in 1837, and in the property being left abandoned to stand the test of time. In 1853, following the Gadsden Purchase, the site would become part of the United States, and in 1868, the establishment of the Diocese of Tucson would allow for regular church services to once again be held at the mission. Finally, in 1872, the Sisters of St. Joseph would open a school at the mission for Tohono O'odham children. Astoundingly, unlike many of the other Spanish missions scattered across Arizona, San Javier there is still actively operated by Franciscans to this day, and continues to serve the native community who constructed it so very long ago. The mission remains open to the public, except for when being utilized for important church services. San Javier del Bac is surrounded by a slew of ghost stories and urban legends, with many visiting reporting a range of inexplicable happenings, including orbs captured in photographs, disembodied footsteps heard from empty areas, and extreme cold spots. At dawn and at dusk, each morning and evening, many near the church have reported sighting a ghostly priest with white hair who walks the grounds once before disappearing, as well as a cat and mouse, believed to be the same cat and mouse depicted above the entrance to the church itself. One local legend claims this cat and mouse signify the world and the end times, and it's said that if this cat is ever sighted catching the mouse, that the world will surely soon end. Another local tale tells that a builder fell while constructing the tower, and that this incident actually contributed to the building never being fully finished. Near the tower, a shadowy figure has been sighted, and many near the area report feeling as if they're constantly being watched. Lastly, in 1949, a schoolhouse next to the mission caught fire, killing a number trapped inside. During the blaze, several witnesses claimed to see a nun that no one recognized, attempting to rescue trapped children and leading them back to the mission. The ghost of this nun has been encountered across the premises, usually limping and covered in char, as she leads a group of spectral children from the direction of where the school once stood. Number 3, the Oatman Hotel, Restaurant, and Saloon. The Oatman, also recognized as the Derlin and located just off Main Street in Oatman, Arizona, is a historic Old West hotel turned ridiculously delicious restaurant and saloon that's widely recognized as the only historic two-story adobe building in the entirety of Mojave County, and that's well known for its range of famous guests, several of which include Clark Gable and Carol Lombard. Initially, this property held the Derlin Hotel, which was constructed by one John Derlin in 1902. Sadly, this original building was destroyed in 1921 when a large fire swept the town. It was eventually reconstructed in 1924 following a lengthy cleanup and restoration process. Later the same year, United Eastern Mines, which stood as the town's major employer, would shut down its local operations, threatening the hotel's livelihood. Fortunately, from 1926 and onward, an influx of motorists traveling the newly paved and now historic Route 66 would breathe new life into the operation, resulting in the hotel switching its business model's focus from miners to travelers and tourists. In 1939, following their wedding in Kingman, Clark Gable and Carol Lombard would stop at the hotel while on their honeymoon. It's said the couple would fall in love with the place and would return often, until Carol's untimely death in 1942. Sadly, in 1953, when roadways that would later become Interstate 50 were constructed to bypass the town, Oatman began to suffer and was all but abandoned by the early 1960s. By the late 60s, the hotel had changed its name from the Derlin to the Oatman. Fortunately, in recent times, a range of historic articles, travel blogs, interest in historic towns, and a general rise in tourism has helped Oatman tremendously. Though its ever-popular hotel no longer offers overnight accommodations, it does boast a deeply revered bar and restaurant on its ground level, as well as a fascinating museum on its upper floor. According to local legend, the Oatman plays host to all manner of supernatural phenomena, with staff and visitors reporting orbs visible to the naked eye, imprints discovered on beds that haven't been slept in for years, and the ghostly form of a man who's been known to photobomb pictures with surprising frequency. Across the property, objects have been sighted moving on their own, disembodied voices have been heard emanating from empty rooms, and the spirit of a former chambermaid has been caught cleaning around the property, and seemingly always vanishes upon discovery. One more famous fable tells of an Irish miner who's said to have lived in the hotel for a time. Tragically, it's said this miner's family perished on their journey to America, and that he ended up drinking himself to death behind the building. Dubbed Odie by staff, his apparition has been heard playing bagpipes across the building, and is blamed for random cold spots throughout its halls. Also reported at the Oatman are glasses flying from shelves, lights flickering with no known cause, and footprints that appear on freshly cleaned floors when the building has been locked and empty. Lastly, the ghosts of none other than Carol Lombard and Clark Gable, who many suspect are returning to better times from life, have been encountered around the property. Their disembodied, affectionate whispers often heard from the suite when the room is completely empty. Number 2, the Superstition Mountains. The Superstition Mountains is a range that spans 160,000 acres across Maricopa, Pinal, and Gila counties in Arizona, with the individual Superstition Mountain itself working as an anchor point at the west end of the federally designated Superstition Wilderness Area, and also acting as a more popular recreation destination to residents of the Phoenix region. Historically, land surrounding the range was inhabited for at least 10,000 years by the Salado, Hohokam, and Apache peoples, until through the 1500s, Spanish explorers accompanied by missionaries arrived. In 1804, Arizona would become part of Alta California under the rule of New Spain, until 1821 when it was declared part of Nueva California under an independent Mexico. Finally, in 1848, following the Mexican-American War, Arizona would officially be ceded to the United States. Through the mid to late 19th century and early 20th century, several prominent mining towns and Mormon settlements would arise on and near the range, and in 1939, the bulk of the area would be set aside as primitive wilderness. In 1964, the range and associated lands were designated as an official wilderness area, and in 1979, the Superstition Mountain Historical Society was formed in an effort to better collect and preserve local histories and legends. Today, the Superstition Mountains remain a popular site for hikers, horseback riders, and nature enthusiasts alike, offering up a whopping 180 miles of trails, which range from maintained pathways to experienced backwoods crawls. Seemingly, from the time of their discovery, this range has acted as a source of countless local legends and ghost stories, and many braving their expanse have reported orbs of light visible to the naked eye, shadowy figures that dart about at night, and full-bodied apparitions ranging from native peoples to more modern figures in clothing spanning the eras. Several native tales tell that somewhere amongst the mountains sits a hole, or cave, leading to a lower world, or hell, and that winds blowing from its depths are the cause of the area's harsh dust storms. Also reported throughout Superstition Wilderness are disembodied voices, otherworldly sounds from the skies, and the constant feeling of being watched or followed. Lastly, one more popular legend tells of the Lost Dutchman's gold mine. As the story goes, through the early to mid 1800s, the Peralta family, who hailed from Mexico, owned a mine in the area and eventually struck a record-breaking gold deposit. Sadly, in 1848, it said they were attacked by Apaches and the only one family member survived. This lone Peralta is said to have later shared the location of their old family mine with German immigrant Jacob Waltz, who's rumored to have become quite wealthy from its treasures. Waltz would later die in Phoenix in 1891, but, according to legend, not before sharing the mine's location with his caretaker Julia Thomas, after which the trail goes cold. From 1892 and onward, countless treasure hunters have gone searching for this lost mine. And, sadly, a number, some claiming around 600 in total, have died while on the trail, many lost to falls, rock slides, dehydration, and even snake bites. Frequent deaths in the region have led to the speculation the treasure may be cursed, and that any who get too near might just meet such a grisly fate. Through the summer of 1931, amateur explorer and treasure hunter Adolf Ruth would go searching for the mine, confident he could accomplish what no one else had prior. Disturbingly, Ruth's skull was located 6 months later, having evidently been shot at point-blank range. Number 1, Jerome. Once dubbed the wickedest town in the West, Jerome, located in the Black Hills of Yavapai County in Arizona, is a historic copper mining town that, though it's often referred to as a ghost town, is now very much alive, boasting a population of around 450 residents, and supporting large annual waves of tourism. The first copper claims in the Jerome region were filed in 1876, with the town starting off as nothing more than a community of mining camps pitched on Cleopatra Hill. In 1880, a majority of the area's claims were purchased up by one Frederick A. Turtle, then governor of the Arizona Territory, along with Frederick F. Thomas, a mining engineer. In 1883, backed by financiers James A. McDonald and Eugene Jerome, the team would establish the United Verde Mining Company. The very same year, Jerome's post office would open its doors, formalizing the town and leading to its rapid growth and expansion. By the following year, in 1884, Jerome boasted a schoolhouse, with a library following later in 1889. Jerome was officially incorporated in 1899, and while business was good for a time, in 1930, after the value of copper fell drastically, mining operations were slowed. Eventually, erosion of the area would result in visible damages to the mines, as well as to the town itself, with several structures literally falling apart as the earth below them shifted. Mining would continue at a reduced rate until 1953, when all operations were officially ceased, and after which Jerome's populace would sharply plummet. Fortunately, in 1967, Jerome's status was elevated to National Historic Landmark, resulting in a much-needed influx of tourism and a welcome economical boom. Today, Jerome has grown into a destination for those interested in history, recreation, travel, and, of course, the paranormal, with a majority of the town's labor force employed in arts, entertainment, retail, or service in one of its various restaurants, wineries, novelty shops, or the infamous Ghost City Inn. The expanse of Jerome is absolutely drenched in stories of the supernatural and local legends, with locals and visitors alike reporting disembodied voices from empty buildings, phantom music on the winds, footsteps, and the hustle and bustle of a crowd where there is none, as if some version of life lived in the town long ago is still playing out somewhere on the other side. As funny as it may sound, at one point, Jerome was known for having more brothels and bordellos than churches and schools, many of these old structures still standing to this day. Several visiting said structures have reported sighting shadowy figures that dart about after dark, the constant feeling of being watched or followed, and even the sensation of being touched by someone or something unseen. Chillingly, several women have reported being grabbed violently or even attacked by what's been described as a hostile male presence. Jenny Bowders was the madame of a brothel called Jenny's Place, and was purportedly once the richest woman in Arizona. Sadly, Jenny was murdered, many ways, long before her time, and it's said her restless spirit might just remain in the old building, which now holds a store. Incidentally, the old Cuban Queen Bordello is said to be haunted by the ghost of one Madame Anita Gonzalez. The Jerome Grand Hotel was first constructed in 1927 as a hospital intended to serve the mines, along with locals to the region, and the old building would eventually reopen in 1996 as the hotel we know today. As legend has it, in its earliest days, an elevator maintenance man by the name of Claude, or Scotty Harvey, was found dead, murdered on the property. Scotty's spirit has been seen and heard throughout the lobby, and is the purported cause behind the elevator sometimes acting as if it has a mind of its own. Chillingly, many died at the old hospital, most deaths resulting from frequent mining accidents, and witness accounts tell of encounters with ghostly patients, doctors, and nurses, as well as the smell of burning or rotting flesh, and ghostly lights through the halls. A female apparition, whom many suspect died during childbirth, has been encountered searching for her newborn, a melancholy look on her face. And a ghostly child has been encountered running through the bar after dark, often causing the room to go quiet and leaving all present in shock. Also reported throughout Jerome, and not isolated to any one spot in particular, are full-bodied apparitions varying in appearance that several, thinking them guides or actors, have had full conversations with, only to turn for a moment to find they've vanished into thin air. Lastly, one more famous fable tells of a presence that haunts Jerome's community center, more formally, Lawrence Hall. Before its construction, land that holds the hall was utilized by a number of working ladies who held small shacks around the site. As legend has it, one of these women was found stabbed to death. Her restless spirit has been sighted throughout Lawrence and has been known to wander the property for minutes before turning towards the hotel and vanishing from sight. Taking into consideration its ridiculously intriguing history, nearly endless list of purported paranormal activity, and mountain of ghostly stories and urban legends, we felt there really was no better choice than the town of Jerome as our pick for the most haunted place in Arizona. Thank you all for tuning in to our second list of picks for some of the most haunted places in Arizona. If you enjoyed hearing our histories and ghost stories as much as we enjoyed telling them to you, don't forget to subscribe to our channel and turn notifications on so you get an alert when fresh content is on the way. Throw us a like if you feel we've earned it, and most importantly, share this upload and our channel with anyone you think deserves a good scare. We'll see you all next time.